Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Due to the negative propaganda against the Quran and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it has become imperative upon us to spread the message of the Quran, inshallah. Therefore, Al-Hikmat kindly requests your support to pledge and sponsor 100,000 Quran drives on CDs. Join us sponsoring Qurans on CDs for free distribution fi sabilillah for Muslims and non-Muslims worldwide. You can also sponsor on behalf of family members and relatives that have passed away as sadaqa jariya. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
Assalamu alaikum. Become an Al-Hikmat AAA member and get discounts from businesses worldwide. By becoming a member, you will receive a free copy of Al-Hikmat magazine and other publications, emails on current events, recent videos on Al-Hikmat TV, YouTube, lectures, interviews, and much more. You can contact Al-Hikmat services at 954-986-0158 or email us at alhikmat@alhikmat.com.
We're bringing them out, right?
Well, you see, brothers and brothers fighting for money and property, sisters, brothers, fathers, children. Look at our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 1400 years ago, he said, "I don't fear that you guys will do shirk, assign partners to Allah. But my fear is you will envy your brother and your sister for worldly things. When they have these worldly accomplishments, you will envy it."
Assalamu alaikum. Allah gives hikmat, wisdom, to whomsoever He wills. And whomsoever is given wisdom is certainly given a lot of good. Only the people of understanding will benefit from the reminder. Tune in to Al-Hikmat TV for khutbas, lectures, and Islamic reminders. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
All praises are due to Allah, Allah. All praises are due to Allah, Allah. Allah, 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 Allah. Allah, 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 Allah.
All praises are due to Allah, Allah. All praises are due to Allah, Allah. Allah, Allah.
Wafiq Transport Limited, contact 715-6463 or 673-0152. Located at 86 Ornfield Road, Caripee, Chima. Services include vacuum, septic services, sock pile, sand gravel, etc. Trailers, heavy equipment for sale such as flatbeds, drop decks, container trailers, and lots more.
Southern Hatcheries Limited. Suppliers of both live and processed broiler chickens. Parts available in both tray packs and case bags to suit your needs. Leg and thighs, wings, liver and gizzard. Also suppliers of both live and processed ducks. All meats strictly halal. Visit us at 440 Komodo Road, Barrackpore. Or call us at 654-3938 or 361-08.
Ya Nabi Salam Alayka, Ya Habib.
Bounty Kings Bounty Castles presents brand new luxury castles for all events. You can contact us at telephone number 749-4342, or you can also email us at bountykings1@gmail.com. A-Class Glamour presents to you wholesaling and retailing of premium lines of cosmetics for all skin types, designer jewelry, and many accessories. Brands include ColourPop, Maybelline, Revlon Professional, Urban Decay, Sephora, and many more. To get a hold of these products, you can call Sadiq Khan at 345-5824 or Amira Khan at 759-6089. You can also visit our Facebook page at A Class Glamour to follow for newly released lines of products.
If you'd like to advertise or be a sponsor of this show, please contact Al Hikmat office. Telephone number 1-954-986-0158 or 1-868-325-8276. Or you can email us at alhikmat@alhikmat.com.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Global Issues on Al Hikmat TV 24/7 online. It is indeed a pleasure to have with us in Al Hikmat studio Rabbi Barry Silver, a very, very, very good friend of mine. We have been friends for many, 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 many years. I have known his father, and his father was a very interesting, very bright intellectual in his field as a rabbi, you know, very loving personality. And I know that trickled off on his son, Rabbi Barry Silver. So again, it's a pleasure to have him with us. Rabbi Barry Silver is a rabbi, an attorney. He has been a former Florida State Representative, a legislator. So it is indeed an honor to have him, and we're going to have a very interesting conversation. Rabbi Silver, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's an honor and a pleasure for me to be here on Al Hikmat. It's always great to be with you, and you have been a great friend of our family. My mother, who's 92 and still working, still playing the piano, she sends her fond regards. She refers to you as her son.
Oh.
And she looks at you like a son, and you've always been so wonderful with our family.
She is really a mother, you know. And yeah. I always remember the day I came by you all in Yom Kippur.
Oh,
it was some other occasion I came by you. Oh,
you've been to our place on a few occasions.
Yes, at your home.
Came to our home on Passover.
Passover, right. As a special guest.
Yeah.
You know, only Jews there and myself, the only Muslim, and my wife at your home.
Well, we're all brothers, Muslims, Jews, we're brothers. So
yes.
It's like you were part of the family.
Well, yeah. Thank you very much, and thank you for coming on the show. It's really a pleasure to have you. And a man with your background and your political background, your religious background, your interfaith background, and your legal background.
Well, I like to talk about all the things that you're not supposed to talk about, otherwise you get into trouble. They always say, if you don't want to upset somebody, don't talk politics, don't talk religion.
Yes.
And that's what I do for a living, politics, religion. So I'm always talking about these things, and it's great to be in a program where you freely exchange views on these topics and people aren't going to get upset with me.
Excellent. That's beauty. You know, if you're in front of a congregation, then people feel personally offended. But
right.
Here on this show, that's the beauty about it, where you can express your opinions.
Yeah.
And you're the legal man, so you know what are the boundaries. So tell me what you think. Let's touch a little bit about some...
I remember a quote from a congressman that I know, Congressman Alcee Hastings.
Uh-huh.
I don't have much to do with most politicians. They don't really interest me too much. But Congressman Hastings is a very outspoken person. He spoke in front of a group once.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember what he said. He said, if I say anything that offends you, I assure you it's completely intentional.
Oh.
And what he meant was, there's a lot of politicians or clergy
yes.
who just say a bunch of nonsense. And they're not really saying much of anything. They don't make any type of point at all because they don't want to offend somebody. And so I think that's horrible. They have as much impact as a white crayon. If we really want to engage people and get them to think, we should challenge them. And sometimes we'll say something and somebody might get a little bit upset about that. And I truly believe that all ministers, and I know you do this too, I've heard you preach and I've heard you speak, we should bring comfort to the afflicted and we should afflict the comfortable.
Excellent. That is really interesting. So, Rabbi, tell me something. You were involved in politics as a Florida state representative.
We're just starting the show and you're insulting me already.
I know. But tell me, just for the benefit of our audience, because, you know, we got people who view the show worldwide, east, yes, west, north and south. Honestly, right, the kind of feedback we get. So tell me, what motivated you to go into politics and what caused you to drop out of politics?
All right. Well, first of all, you know what politics is, right? It's very easy to define. A tick is a bloodsucker. And poly means many.
Uh-huh.
So politics means many bloodsuckers.
Oh, my goodness. There's a bunch of bloodsuckers. That's what I'm
saying. Another way of looking at it is the opposite of pro is con, right? Pro and con. Therefore, the opposite of progress is congress.
Whoa.
So that's another way of looking at politics.
And that's what makes you that smart guy out there.
Now, that explains why I'm not in office anymore. Because my colleagues didn't particularly care for my views about politics. I call them not so much politicians, but polluticians, because they're usually polluting the world and doing things that are harmful to the environment. What motivated me to get involved in the political world is, since I was very, very young, I always wanted to get involved in government and in politics because I wanted to try to make the world a better place.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I thought there were a few different ways that I could do that. One, just trying to be a good guy, which I try to do. But also, professionally, if I was a lawyer, I figure I can sue the government and I can give them something to think about next time they pass some bad law or bad policies. And mm-hmm. if there's people out there who need help,
yes,
as a lawyer, as an attorney, you can represent them and you can cause a lot of damage to the power structure and the status quo and a lot of help and good for people in need.
And as a person like you with that kind of religious background, as a rabbi, come from a very religious background, your father being a rabbi, so you went in there to make policies and get things good for the country and the people, but then you realize it's all about
the
opposite.
That's why I became a lawyer. As far as going into politics, yes, I wanted to get into politics so I could try to bring reforms mm-hmm. and change the system. And I found that I served in the state of Florida, which is really a microcosm to politics in general in the United States. What happens in the Florida legislature is very similar to what happens in the United States Congress and in Washington. And what I found there was really appalling. And I did actually quote Jesus, which is unusual because rabbis don't usually quote Jesus, mm-hmm. but you know, he was one of us. He was a nice Jewish boy, nice rabbi. So,
well, you know, in Islam, we believe him.
Oh, I know. He's one of your prophets.
Prophet. Okay. Right. And that's what makes us such an interesting peer, because we have differences of opinion on many different issues. But that's the bond. That's what makes people.
Well, your view and our view, Muslim and Jewish view on Jesus, is pretty similar. Because you hold that he didn't undergo the resurrection on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you don't also believe in the virgin birth, if I'm not.
Oh, no.
You accept the virgin birth?
We accept the virgin birth. We accept him as a prophet. But we don't believe that he was crucified.
Yeah,
we believe that God saved him. He was raised up physically as opposed to being crucified. But anyhow, we're not here talking about religion now. We want to talk on some global issues.
I was in the Florida legislature,
uh-huh.
and I said to the other legislators, they were passing some law that was going to do great damage to the Florida Everglades and to the Florida environment.
Mm-hmm.
And I said at that point, quoting Jesus but paraphrasing, Jesus said when he upset the tables at the temple, and he said that they were corrupting the temple, he said, "You've turned my father's house into a den of thieves."
Mm-hmm.
His father's house meaning the temple. So I, on the Florida legislature, said, "You've turned the people's house into a den of iniquity by passing laws that are going to destroy the environment." I said, "All of those people who believe in a creator, the worst form of blasphemy is to destroy creation. And in Florida, we have a unique ecosystem, the Everglades, and these laws are going to destroy the Everglades." So they didn't really care for that too much. They also named the Florida Turnpike after Ronald Reagan,
uh-huh.
who was a conservative Republican. And I said on the floor of the House, I said, "I know a lot of people respect and admire Ronald Reagan. And me personally, I think he was a good guy. He was a nice person. But his policies are totally against what I believe in, and it's divisive. Why don't you name it after Marjorie Stoneman Douglas, someone who devoted her life to protecting the environment? So when I was in the legislature, I sang a song. I wrote a song for you.
Of course, I'm
a great fan of yours.
You're a writer, you're everything.
I couldn't help but write a song and to sing it for you, and I did that here. But my song in the Florida legislature was a little bit different. Uh-huh. I made fun of the Florida Turnpike. There's a song from the 1950s, and I remember a little bit of it. It started out like this. In the legislative session of 98, way down south in the Sunshine State, the legislature said, wouldn't it be great to make a new Ron Reagan Turnpike? Ron, you're the one they like, so they put your name on our turnpike. Yeah. As for me, I prefer my bike to the new Ron Reagan Turnpike. And then it went on verse after verse, making fun of the whole situation.
Whoa.
And when I was done, they didn't care for me too much. Now, also, the Democratic Party took issue with me as well. Because when I was elected, the Democratic Party took all of the new people who just got elected, and they wanted to show them the ropes. Mm-hmm. So they said, let us teach you how things go. Here's a list of lobbyists. Call these people up, find out what they want, have them take you out for breakfast or lunch or dinner, and then tell them what they need to know so that they'll donate money to the party. And I found that appalling. Mm-hmm. And I refused. And I told the power structure in the Democratic Party, I said, I will raise issues, I will raise awareness, but I will not raise money. I'm not here to raise funds, I'm here to raise consciousness. And I will go out and speak to any groups you want. I will go out and work hard for causes and ideals that we believe in. But I'm not going to raise money. And I'm not selling my soul to the highest bidder. I refuse. And because of that, the Democratic Party worked hard to take me out. They considered me to be disloyal because I wouldn't raise money for the party.
Well, speaking about that, that sounds interesting. You know why? Because personally, I believe a man like you should be in politics because you got that know-how, you got the 9 yards of understanding. But I understand, as a rabbi and from a religious background and your love for humanity and the corruption that we have in politics, that brings a wall between you and reality. So I agree with you not being involved, but I would love to see people like you, and I think you should be the kind of person. But now that we are in a very interesting time in the United States of America with the present politics and the present political situation, the Democrats, the Republicans, and Mr. Trump, the president, you know, that's interesting. I say Republicans separate, Democrats separate, and President Trump separate, because he has a whole different style, a different vision, and a different leadership kind of dynamics, if you want to put it like that. Because, I mean, we may disagree, but he is a billionaire. He's a successful businessman.
I wouldn't call it leadership what he's demonstrating.
Yeah, well, I know we differ on that. He's a smart guy. I know he makes some crazy statements, and I disagree with him on the crazy statements, and I think he disagrees with himself on his crazy statements.
Well, he does. He says the opposite every other day.
Yes.
He just said when he was campaigning, I will be the best friend of the transgender community ever. And then just yesterday, he says, transgender people can't serve in the military.
Yes.
Well, maybe he's being their friend, because in the military, he's their boss. Yes. So maybe he realizes he's doing them a favor by not being their boss anymore. But in all seriousness, telling people who are loyal Americans that they can't serve, and coming from someone who deferred service in the military, and coming from someone who castigated McCain because he got captured, and coming from someone who compared the sacrifice that he made in hiring people to the sacrifice that someone made when they lost a son in Iraq, this is an outrage. This is not leadership by any stretch of the imagination. This is the opposite of leadership.
I know we're talking about global issues here, right? But America is one of the most global issue in the world.
Of
Wherever
course.
You go, everybody speak about America. America is the most powerful democratic country in the world, you know. You may have other countries that are democratic and they got greater numbers, but when it comes to power and leadership, America has it. So this is a global issue because the entire world looks up. They were following the elections here, the whole political campaign. So what is your take on this? I mean, it's a year, it's almost going into a year now, very soon in a couple of months. But what's your take about the Democrats and what they stand for? I mean, let's be very, very frank here as a rabbi, a religious person with political background, legal background, and our show is open to the world. For the viewers out there, what's your take? Let's be very just, not party line.
Well, I've always been very honest, and I've always been free to criticize, as you noticed so far.
Yes, I know that.
The Democratic Party.
That's why I can
and
talk
so, right,
to you.
I call it like I see it. And
what do you think caused the Democrats to lose this election?
The Democratic Party tried to be Republican light. They tried to be like the Republicans, but a little watered down a bit. It's like I told you, when I got into the Florida legislature, they told us to raise money from lobbyists. That is so horrendous. I knew at that moment that the Democratic Party was in serious trouble. And from then, I've seen a free fall in the Democratic Party. I mean, think about it. If you can't beat Donald Trump, the biggest liar, the biggest fraud and charlatan, if you can't beat him in election, something is seriously the matter. And the Democratic Party has certain ideals that sound beautiful, just like American ideals sound great. They want to protect the environment. They want to provide health care to people. They want to look after the poor and the underprivileged. They want to educate people. They want to do all these things, but they try to raise money.
But do you think they were really real about that? It's only talk, and it's more about money and the rich and who has it, got it. And it was more about talk as opposed to action?
There are some people, especially in the grassroots, who get involved in politics because they believe in the ideals of the Democratic Party. But the people who are at top, the politicians, in general, their number one issue is staying in office.
It's not so much about a country and
no,
the
no,
people.
No. Staying in office. When I was in the legislature, I heard repeatedly, don't say that, it's going to cost you votes. Don't do this, it's going to get you in trouble with the power structure. Don't say this, the speaker's going to be mad at you. I was on the floor of the House and I was speaking about abortion rights, which I feel very strongly about. And I was told, unless you remain silent and don't say a word about this, the speaker has told us that you will never get a bill passed because the speaker controls what bills get heard and what don't. And you will never receive a dime for your district. And if you can't pass a bill, and if you can't raise money for your district, you're worthless and you will be voted out. And they told me, don't talk about that. They also told me, don't say a word about the Reagan Turnpike because the speaker likes it. And if you do, he'll be mad at you. And I said, I am not going to start now going down a path where I'm censored. I will say what I want. And I might only last 2 years, but I'll have a good time here and I'll be true to myself. I am not going to do that. And that's what happens. When you get into government, they say, don't say this, otherwise the party's going to be upset. Don't do this, otherwise you have to work
the deal. So it's basically all about the party and remaining in position.
Absolutely. And the issues are totally secondary. The people on the street, there's people on the street who care about these issues who are Democrats. But once you get to that level, people start to think in terms of staying on.
You technically get muzzled, sort of.
No, way. I didn't. They actually have newsletters that you could send out. You send out a newsletter to your constituents, and you can tell them what's going on in Tallahassee. It's a report from you, what's going on in the government. Mm-hmm. So I sent out a newsletter, and it has to go through the speaker first. They have to approve it. And my newsletter was totally different than anything else that ever went out. My newsletter said, this week we just destroyed Florida's environment. This week we just passed legislation that's going to seriously undermine the education of our kids. this might be the last newsletter you'll get from me, because I'm going to be silenced. They're telling me already I'm not allowed to send this out, so read what's going on. And I've told them exactly what's happening, and the speaker was outraged. And he said, you're not going to be allowed to have any funds necessary to send this out. And I said, I'll send it out myself. I'll pay for it this time. I could only do it once, but I'm not going to be censored. But that's how it works. If you say something that's a little off the mainstream or that criticizes the body, they get upset with you.
So because it's all about talking about issues, but ensuring your position is there. So it's more about yourself, the position.
That's the main thing.
As opposed to the issues. Now, let's say about...
No, and one other thing. You have to make it appear... It's creating an appearance.
Are we seeing hypocrisy here?
Yes. You're creating an appearance that you really care about these issues. You're creating an appearance that you're going to pass something that's going to help the environment. Countless times we had bills in Florida that the legislature called, like, this is the clean air thing. Something that's going to help the environment. In actuality, it was doing the opposite.
So it's Trump right when he says fake news, because a lot of them come forth and they pretend that we care and we this, and they promote a different thing. And then it's really fake. It's all about a position.
Well, I
don't want you to be biased.
I don't want to overstate it. There are many politicians who, in addition to staying in office, also try to do the right thing.
Like Obama.
He was watered down. He was diluted. But
you could see that Obama loved people.
Yes,
he cared for the country. But,
right.
But he was controlled by those very same people.
Obama favored universal health care. When he was a state rep, he said, universal health care. Everybody should be provided health care. The government should provide that. And then he ran for president, and he received millions and millions and millions of dollars from the insurance industry. And then all of a sudden, universal health care, he never said a word about it. Instead, he comes up with something that we call Obamacare. Do you know where that came from? It was Mitt Romney's proposal. It was a Republican proposal from Mitt Romney that he did. Why? In order to compromise. And when you compromise so much that you compromise your soul and your beliefs, he should have at least, if he wanted to compromise, he should have at least spoke his mind and said, the only system that is fair, that's adopted by countries all over the world, industrialized countries except the U.S., is a universal health care where the government provides health care. Because if you don't have the right to health, then the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, these are not rights. They are illusions.
So what we're saying is,
if you don't have your health, you have nothing.
So what we're saying, Obama was real. He loved the people. He cared. But then he got watered down by these.
Right. He got corrupted or watered down or started playing the
games. By these politicians who are just about position.
Who wanted to help the party. The Democratic Party receives vast amounts of money from the insurance industry.
So are you saying they give priority to the party as opposed to the country and the people? Which is wrong.
They give, right, first of all, they give priority to the party.
Uh-huh.
But in order to make the party have funds necessary to pay for the vast amounts of money the party needs, the party sells its soul to the special interests, the insurance lobby, or the medical lobby.
And I think that's what Trump beat them on.
Or the coal and oil industry. Now, here's what Trump did.
No, you know what? I know. We've got to go on a commercial break. We have been rolling for the past 20 minutes.
It's been great.
That's the interest. This is an international issue. Wherever you go, Rabbi, in the world, people are talking about Trump, America, Democrats, Republican. And I really love the idea that a person like you can come on this show who have had the experience, who have the experience, who is very vocal, and everyone, understands and know you with your experience. So when we come back, we want to touch a little bit on the Republican side, on Trump and the Republican side. Because I think it is interesting for people to know. Right now, there's a major imbalance. Jews, Christians, Muslims, people who believe and don't believe in America, they're totally confused with the same situation.
Right.
And it's not two things. It's Democrats, Republican, and President Trump, because you have three different views flying around in America, major. So people are totally confused. And I would love to hear it from a person like you when we come back. So, my dear viewers, it is a pleasure. It's really a blessing and an honor again to have Rabbi Barry Silver with us, a rabbi, legislator, former Florida state representative, for those of you who just came on the show. a lawyer, a man with a lot of experience out there. And, you know, politics is hot all the time, and especially now in the United States of America and in the world. So we're going to continue. We've heard his views on the Democrats. Now we're going to hear his views on President Trump and the Republican and the world and America and how things are going on. Stay tuned when we come back.
We're praying for that, right? Well, you see, brothers and brothers fighting for money and property. Sisters, brothers, fathers, children. Look at our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. 1400 years ago, he said, I don't fear that you guys will do shirk, assign partners to Allah. But my fear is you will envy your brother and your sister for worldly things. When they have these worldly accomplishments, you will envy it.
Assalamu alaikum. Allah gives hikmat, wisdom, to whomsoever He wills. And whomsoever is given wisdom is certainly given a lot of good. Only the people of understanding will benefit from the reminder. Tune in to Al-Hikmah TV for khutbas, lectures, and Islamic reminders. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
All praises are due to Allah. All praises are due to Allahu Allah. All praises are due to Allahu Allah. Allahu 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 Allah. Allahu 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 Allah.
All praises are due to Allahu Allah. All praises are due to Allahu Allah. Allahu Allah.
Welcome back to Hikmah TV. We are on Global Issues with Rabbi Barry Silver, a rabbi, a lawyer, legislator, and a former Florida State Representative. We've had a very interesting conversation with him before we went on a commercial break. So those of you who have just tuned on, we were talking about his views on Democrats and the present political situation in the United States of America, which is an issue worldwide, and the whole world are always focused on America and America election and politics. So now we're going to continue a little bit on his views on President Trump and the Republicans, because as a man, as a humanitarian person, he is really concerned about the people, the country, and that's what I love about him. Again, Rabbi Silver. So tell us, do you think that because of those issues, the Republicans, as we were talking about with the Democrats, you know, the Republicans are more on issues? Yeah, everybody basically on position and money. That's a natural human error. But they are more very vocal and clear, and they really don't care what people think about them when it comes to the issues they stand for.
Well, first of all, I'm not sure if I'm going to have time later on to say this, so let me just say it now. We're here at Al-Hikmat Interfaith Sanctuary.
Yes.
What a blessing this place is to the community, to have a sanctuary that you have provided for the community to bring people together of different faiths. It's just amazing. When I was here before and I heard you announce it, I was thrilled. And I was here with my son, Ari.
Thank you, Rabbi.
This is amazing. This is what religion should be doing. See, you are practicing what most ministers only preach. You are practicing bringing people together around love and harmony and understanding. And you augment it by this amazing show. So I appreciate
thank you
putting me on this show, because this is something that is really thrilling for me and I know for your audience. Now, to answer your question.
I want to respond to that by having a person like you with your background. You know, we thought that it's a blessing because you have this experience and with that religious balance or biblical balance or godly balance or righteous balance in your thinking, you know, it's so interesting that you will give a just opinion on the present political situation.
Well, you know, most people, they would look at the two of us and they think, I guess they don't have much in common. One's Muslim, one's Jewish. Mm-hmm. They'd be wrong.
They've told
you and I have so much in common. The way we view the world, the way we look at humanity, and the approach that we have to religion is virtually identical. It's the same approach coming from two different traditions that are as close together as brothers or mother and daughter. But to answer your question, I don't want to leave a false impression.
Right.
The Democratic Party in my opinion, is light years ahead of the Republican Party, and they do deeply care about issues. Mm-hmm. They champion health care and education and gun control and helping the poor. But because they think that they need to raise money, that, if you'll pardon the expression, often trumps the actual issue. And so they're championing these issues, from my perspective, mm-hmm. is watered down. Mm-hmm. President Obama did a great job compared to so many other presidents and any Republican president we've ever had except for Lincoln. But because he was concerned about raising money, his issues became diluted. I would say it this way. The Democrats say the right thing, but don't always do the right thing. Mm. The Republicans say the wrong thing and do the wrong thing.
Oh.
And so therefore, to me, the Republican Party is a disaster, an absolute disaster. For instance, the greatest environmental threat in the world today is global warming.
Mm-hmm.
For eons of time in world history, parts of the United States and parts of the world have been underwater because the temperature rose a little bit. And so Florida used to be a series of islands and archipelagos. It doesn't take a lot for the coastline to disappear. Same thing with Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, and the United States.
Mm-hmm.
But around the world, there's major population centers along the coast that would be threatened with disappearing off the face of the earth. And what is the Republican response to the greatest environmental threat ever? Ignorance, denial, saying it's a hoax. And then you have the worst, most pathetic example of that in Donald Trump, someone who takes all the faults and follies of the Republican Party and puts it on steroids. You know, Donald.
Do you think that the Republicans are all about themselves?
Oh, my. They've elevated greed to.
It's all about selfishness.
They idolize money. Why else would anyone think that Donald Trump could possibly be qualified to be leader of the free world? Why would it be? Because the Republicans worship money and greed. And therefore, in their mind, someone who's a billionaire has to be smarter, has to be better, has to be more virtuous. He's got more money, therefore he's got more brains, more virtue, more everything. So they constantly look for billionaires to run the country. But how do you make a lot of money in the United States? Is it by being the most virtuous? Is it by being the most honest? Is it by making the greatest contribution? No. If it was based on your contribution, a teacher or a doctor would be the wealthiest. It's based usually on screwing somebody, taking advantage of somebody, misleading someone, playing the system. It's doing something that's not quite kosher.
Would you say that the Republicans are racial in some areas?
Are racial?
They are racial in some area. They have that superiority race complex.
Oh, my goodness. The United States has done some really good things. We've spread ideas of democracy and freedom throughout the world. But we've also done some horrific things, some horrible things. But Trump says, the United States is the greatest country ever. We're better than everybody else. And who's his hero? Who is his hero? President Andrew Jackson. He's got a picture of him in the Oval Office. President Andrew Jackson led a death march. He led Native Americans because other white Americans wanted their land. They forcefully took the land. He defied the Supreme Court, took the land, marched them off the land, and led them to Oklahoma on a death march. Thousands didn't make it. And what was that called? That death march was called the Trail of Tears. He was a slave-owning, genocidal maniac who took them on a Trail of Tears, and that's his hero. Well, I can see why. Trump is taking the United States on a Trail of Tears. But it's not just the United States. It's the entire world that he is leading on a Trail of Tears. That's his hero. Yes, he venerates money. Money trumps everything, including the planet. He treats Mother Earth the same way he treats all the other women in his life. He abuses them, he exploits them, and then he moves on.
Do you think it's because of money?
The only problem is there's only one earth. And once he exploits that, it's gone. Yes, to him, to Donald Trump, who is the most sacrilegious person, he doesn't look at creation as sacred. He views the earth as a commodity. The sacred ground of the earth in which the sun shines and food grows out of the ground, in which you have natural beauty, you have biodiversity that's evolved over billions of years, he sees none of it. All he sees in the earth is a commodity to be used, exploited, and turned into a profit. And what happens to the next generation? He couldn't care less, because he wants to make his money now. And in the future, what our children are going to inherit doesn't mean a darn thing to him. That is the height of irresponsibility. And to think that such a person would be leading the United States in the free world is a nightmare that is now coming true. And every person, I've led many anti-Trump marches and rallies. Every person should do what they can to marginalize him so that he will no longer be effective at all, and hopefully will be impeached before too long.
What do you think about his religious background? Do you think he's a man of God and he is God conscious?
You know,
or does he only look at everything and every decision is through the dollar?
Some people follow God and some people follow gold. And between God and gold, there's an L of a difference. He follows gold. He has no concept of a divinity. He is his own divinity. He said that he has a big brain and he has no advisors. He lied about everything, including when he said the Bible was his favorite book. Remember, he said, my favorite book is The Art of the Deal? And then somebody said to him, well, what about the Bible? And then he realized, oh yeah, that's right, I need the Christians to vote for me, that's right. Oh yeah,
yeah.
The Bible, that's my favorite book. Now think about it for a minute. What does the Christian Bible actually say? Jesus says, if somebody strikes you, turn the other cheek.
Mm-hmm.
What did his wife say? If you strike him, he's going to hit you 10 times harder. When is the last time he turned the other cheek? The Bible says that you should beat your swords into plowshares, your spears into pruning hooks. Jesus said, those who live by the sword die by the sword. If Jesus didn't care for a sword, what would he think about a semi-automatic weapon that could kill 100 people in seconds? He's never met a weapon he doesn't like. He does the exact opposite of everything in the Bible. The Bible says repeatedly to help the poor. He has no interest in helping the poor. He's helping the rich. It says in the Christian scripture, a wealthy person has the same chance of getting into heaven as a camel has in getting through the eye of a needle.
Yeah.
By that
yeah.
standard, there's no way he's going to see heaven. You think his favorite book is one that says he's going straight downstairs in a handbasket? He couldn't care less about the Bible. You know, when he was inaugurated, he wanted to use his own Bible. They said, we have one here. He said, no, I want to use mine. Do you know why? Because it's never been used.
I like that.
It's never been opened.
Oh, you want an untouched Bible because
it's in a pristine state.
It's an inauguration, so it's untouched.
That's right.
That's interesting. But tell me something, Rabbi. Looking at his involvement with the evangelist, and he was very strong in their support, and they supported him. Do you think, because, you know, I'm very neutral. I'll be very honest with you. I'm very neutral when it comes to, and that's why I agree with your points, and that's why we're talking about it here. On values that the Republicans got and values of the Democrats, as well as values of President Trump. You know, I admire certain qualities in him, but I respect what you have said. And yes, in a lot of times he says one thing, he does the other. And we see this, and I personally agree with you when it comes to money, that he looks at everything through the dollar. And therefore he cannot find a balance. It's all about money. Do you think if the evangelist who helped him in the election supported him and worked with him, do you think they need to preach some God into him?
The evangelical Christians who supported Donald Trump in large measure showed themselves to be the worst form of hypocrites ever. to support someone who abuses women, who speaks of women in such derogatory terms, someone who makes a mockery of the White House, someone who lies every chance he gets, someone who wants to destroy the planet, doesn't care about the poor, does everything, everything the opposite of Jesus. If you were to try to paint a picture of the Antichrist, someone who is the exact polar opposite of Jesus, it would be Donald Trump. Jesus went around in sandals. He said, if you want to be my follower, sell all of your possessions and give the proceeds to the poor. He is the opposite. And for evangelical Christians to follow him and support him shows themselves to be the worst form of hypocrites. They, the evangelical Christians, have committed the worst case of identity theft against Jesus I've ever seen. Jesus was liberal. Jesus was kind-hearted. Jesus was meek. Jesus was a Jewish nationalist. And they took a Jewish liberal and made him into a Christian conservative. And they've stolen his identity and turned his teachings on their head. And they showed themselves to be hypocrites when they supported Donald Trump, and still do.
Because, I mean, let's be very frank here. The evangelists promote a lot of this, of Jesus' teaching. And
they promote the opposite of it. Everything they say, the evangelical fundamentalist Christians, everything they say is the opposite of what Jesus taught. They use Jesus in order to try to manipulate people and to gain power. They don't talk about selling your possessions and helping the poor. They don't talk about practicing. Jesus was a communist. Jesus said, take everything you have, give it to the poor, and let the government provide for people. Jesus was the exact opposite of these fundamentalists. Jesus said you shouldn't pray in public. He said, if you want to pray to the Father, go into a closet and pray quietly. Don't let other people hear, because that's what the hypocrites do. They pray in public. The fundamentalist Christians, they want prayer in the school, prayer in the government. They want their Ten Commandments all over the place. They want to show this is a Christian nation, which it isn't. They do the opposite. They're not practicing religion. They're practicing the opposite of religion. And Jesus said, there will be many people who will come in my name and claim to be my followers, and they're not. They're the opposite. And he said you could judge a prophet by his fruits. Mm-hmm. And the fruits of the evangelical Christians is just bad news.
But if some true Christians, let's put
yes,
it like that.
There are many true Christians.
Yes.
There are liberal, progressive Christians.
We got a lot of very good Christians.
There's a lot of great Christians who are donating their lives to helping the poor, to doing good works. There's a lot of great Christians.
So we're not speaking of Christians. We're
speaking of the evangelical fundamentalist Christians. They are doing the opposite.
Who are into the money business, the show business. And that's why they were in this very
superior,
complex business.
There's millions of Christians all over the world who are actually living up to the ideals of
Jesus.
So
what you're seeing, a lot of these evangelists, they're more into America is theirs alone, not other people. Nobody else should be here. It's only them, the rich, the wealthy.
Those evangelical Christians supported slavery. They used the Bible to support slavery. Those evangelical fundamentalist Christians supported the genocide against Native Americans because they were heathens in their opinion and therefore didn't deserve to live. Christianity has been used for some horrible things, and that's why the founding fathers of this country said that they had no use for Christianity at all. They said it did a lot of horrible things. They loved Jesus, and they thought his teachings were good. But organized Christianity, they thought was bad news. Today, we do have liberal, progressive
And that's
Christians.
Some of the reason why they separated church and state.
Right, exactly.
Because they did not want the rich and the powerful to use Christianity and use Jesus and the Bible
and you
to
know
take
why?
Advantage of other people.
Because they believed that when you put Christianity or government and religion together, you destroy the independence of government and religion. They cherished religion and they cherished government and believed they should always be separate and distinct in order to bring out the best in both of them. They also, in the Treaty of Tripoli, which was written under the administration of George Washington, signed under the administration of Adams and passed unanimously, they said the United States is not a Christian nation and we have no issue with Islam whatsoever. And President Trump has gone against that. President Trump has acted like Joe McCarthy. Joe McCarthy was a Democrat, and then he switched to Republican, took over the party, took the party and drove it into the gutter, humiliated the whole Republican Party by getting them all to follow after him. And then years later, people realized, what a horrible thing. He scapegoated communists. Trump is following the same blueprint, but he's not scapegoating communists. He's scapegoating the Muslim community, and he's scapegoating others, like people who speak Spanish. You know, I speak Spanish with my kids. And he says, we're in America. We speak English here. How ridiculous. How parochial. I mean, I'm not allowed to speak Spanish with my kids. I can't go into a synagogue and speak Hebrew because we're in America. You can't speak Arabic. How silly is that? He's a xenophobe. He's making enemies out of people to build himself up. And today, when he's all over the news because of the Russia investigation, all of a sudden he comes out, transgender people can't serve in the military. He's always got to have a scapegoat.
So let me ask you, Rabbi, we just got about 3 or 4 minutes again. Would you believe we have been speaking for more than 45 minutes? And you got to come back on this show. I know we...
At the drop of a yarmulke, yes, I'll be here. Anytime.
We concentrated a lot on politics and America and the present situation, which I think is very important for the world out there to know. But we got to come back and have a show on religion in the world. And
absolutely.
You know, I know you're a specialist on that also.
We're absolutely
on politics here, on religion, whether it's Judaism, Christianity, Islam, Muslims in America, in the world, and talk of some of these religious issues, how people use and abuse religion, and we got to come back on another show. But last, before we conclude, and I'll give you the closing remarks, I still personally believe that if some good Christian were to get hold of Trump and preach God into him because of his strong-headedness, and could get that vision out of money from him and get him away from making decisions based on the dollar as opposed to the God-gifted opportunity to be president of America, and try to guide him on the right path, you know, we could hope and pray that he could change. But he got to look away from that. He got to change his vision, because I agree with you. He's letting money make his decision. He'd respect nobody. You know, that's a big problem. He does not respect anybody. Doesn't matter who is around him, he does not respect.
Well, you know, one of the founders of Israel, Ben-Gurion, said, a Jew who doesn't believe in miracles is not a realist. And the establishment of Israel is considered a miracle. And the reestablishment of Hebrew as a spoken language. So as a Jew, I believe in miracles.
Oh,
so what you're
goodness.
Saying is possible,
yes,
because I believe in miracles. But Trump's North Star,
uh-huh,
his guiding light, is self-interest and greed. So there are cases where people have been transformed and born again, mm-hmm, but that's what it would take.
It will take a miracle. Okay, let's hope that it'll be a miracle and it will happen.
I do want to come back because I have some great parodies on Trump that I want to sing.
And
it's been a real great pleasure to be with you. I'll definitely have to do it again.
We're talking for more than 45 minutes.
Unbelievable.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
So I give you the last word, closing remarks of being with us here today, a couple of seconds as we conclude.
Sure. What you're doing here is really what religion's all about. You see, too many people use religion to build walls of separation. I'm better than you are. My God is better than your God. My book's better than your book. But there's another way of viewing religion, a totally different way. Instead of building up walls of separation, to build bridges of understanding.
Yes.
And that's what happens here at Al-Hikmat. Hikmat is related to the Hebrew word chachma. They both mean wisdom. And our languages are as close together as brothers. The closest religion to Judaism is Islam. The closest language to Hebrew is Arabic. And what you're doing by bringing people together, what a blessing.
Thank you.
A great blessing. And to be able to be included in this effort of yours, this is a great day for me. And I hope the people out there not only enjoy this episode, but appreciate what you're doing to use religion as it should be, to bring people together.
Thank you very much, Rabbi. And it has been a pleasure to have Rabbi Barry Silver with us. Again, for those of you who have just tuned in, Rabbi Barry Silver is an attorney at law. He's a rabbi, former Florida state representative, legislator, you know, a man of great high-level IQ and intelligence. And that conversation was so interesting. We are going to bring him back on the show, and we want to talk about religion. You know, two very interesting things. Politics and religion are two topics that people don't really want to discuss. But we're going to discuss that with Rabbi, because he's blessed with that sort of ability. We have spoken about politics in America, the most powerful democratic country in the world, Democrats, Republicans, President Trump. And we're going to bring him back very soon. So you stay tuned to Al-Hikmat TV 24/7 online. And religion and politics and the world, we will be talking about with Rabbi Silver. So we want to thank Rabbi Silver and thank all of you worldwide for viewing Al-Hikma TV 24/7 online.
All praises are due to Allah, Allah. All praises are due to Allah, Allah. Allah, 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 Allah. Allah, 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 Allah.
All praises are due to Allah, Allah. All praises are due to Allah, Allah, Allah.
Wafiq Transport Limited, contact 715-6463 or 673-0152. Located at 86 Ornfield Road, Caripe, Chima. Services include vacuum, septic services, sock pile, sand gravel, etc. Trailers, heavy equipment for sale such as flatbeds, drop decks, container trailers, and lots more.
Southern Hatcheries Limited. Suppliers of both live and processed broiler chickens. Parts available in both tray packs and case bags to suit your needs. Leg and thighs, wings, liver and gizzard. Also suppliers of both live and processed ducks. All meats strictly halal. Visit us at 440 Komodo Road, Barrackpore. Or call us at 654-3938 or 361-0800.
Bounty Kings, Bounty Castles presents brand new luxury castles for all events. You can contact us at telephone number 749-4342 or you can also email us at bountykings1@gmail.com. A-Class Glamour presents to you wholesaling and retailing of premium lines of cosmetics for all skin types, designer jewelry, and many accessories. Brands include ColourPop, Maybelline, Revlon Professional, Urban Decay, Sephora, and many more. To get a hold of these products, you can call Sadiq Khan at 345-5824 or Amira Khan at 759-6089. You can also visit our Facebook page at A Class Glamour to follow for newly released lines of products.
If you'd like to advertise or be a sponsor of this show, please contact Al Hikmat office. Telephone number 1-954-986-0158 or 1-868-325-8276, or you can email us at alhikmat@alhikmat.com.
Truly he is the one, he has no father or son. Truly.